Hi, I'm Marla Burkholder, Artistic Director of Intercultural Journeys, and I'm thrilled to introduce the third episode of this close-up series, curated by the incomparable Ursula Rucker. There's still one more episode to come in this series, so I hope you will also join us in March for Ursula Rucker with Jacqueline Constance. And our season will culminate in May with the in-person premiere of the Francis Suite, composed and performed by Ruth Naomi Floyd, featuring Diane Monroe and Yolanda Wisher. Check our website, interculturaljourneys.org, for more information about all of these performances and to support the ongoing work of these amazing artists through your ticket purchase or donation. Tonight's close-up performance features poet and musician Sham-e-Ali Nayeem. She's speaking to us from a beautiful Philadelphia garden, but her words stretch back generations and across worlds as she pieces together her story with those who have come before her as ancestors and artists. Thank you for being with us this evening, and please enjoy Close-Ups with Sham-e-Ali Nayeem.
Impossible. In response to the Muslim ban, how do you ban soul, spring, stars, a butterfly's path, dense ocean, basin, currents? How do you ban the orbit of moon?
Invocation. My dad walks with me in the mornings. The sun is new. Even in the cold, I can feel him in unknown spaces and collapse. If I were sad, he'd bring me fruit and water. If I were scared, he'd listen and offer counsel. He would give me a poem. He would tell me a joke. And I would know that he was there. I've never seen my dad cry, but I have seen him leave this world. I felt him as a machine and sang a flat note parallel to a digital line on a screen. I reached for his hand. Dad walks with me in the mornings. He taught me how to plant things. He showed me how to herd sheep, to pay attention to life force, listen to the earth. He would tell me, this is but a moment. He would tell me, you're a good mom. He would show me maps in the sky and how evergreens never lose their emerald. He would read Ayatul Kursi with smell of safety and rose water. He would say, Aleph, Lam, Mim. There. He would say, this world is full of secrets. He would say, listen.
Strangers on the train. He's the first to notice a face gone blank in a train car of the oblivious.
noticed her conversation with the door closed on half her body and the slow beginnings of a train picking up speed. She's trying to pull herself in while he pulls an emergency stop cord. Strangers say, I care for you best because they have no reason to care. No one knows each other's names or how work was that day. Or will I ever speak to you again? Only, are you okay? Yes, thank you. See you around. I see you. Before bombing, it's about to happen. Cure to disease extinguished. Answers to questions hanging. The unfinished tea is still warm on the table. Of lips dry on the edge of glass. Echinacea and salvias miss the ones that watered them. Bouquets of sharp trajectories push into hands that never wish to hold them. At the morgue during war is a ledger, thick with soft pages worn. Someone maintains it with care. Their handwriting precise. Ink covering pages like blue drop sapphire, a grieving stream, a weeping sky. Partition story. 1. My father left this world, and with him, some of his story. I have small bits, but not the whole. This is the story where we have returned to Hyderabad together, back to the graves of my grandparents, back to the things that are no longer there. Maybe he would tell me how much has changed. Maybe he would tell me what was here once. The path that he walked to school. The places that he loved the most.
This is the story
I was waiting for. Two. I cling to glimpses of things shared quickly over kitchen tables. Somber sits in silver bowls like constellations as he mentions long walks by the cattails, photographs of reflections in the water, places that he worked, his love of learning, a determination to save lives. But I never got the full story. It would sit there on the edge of his lips, like a small cloud. Maybe he let that story on the Dukkan Plateau. Maybe he wasn't looking back. Or maybe I never asked. Three. In a frame is a picture of a small boy, not smiling, post-partition India, standing straight with a heavy bag of books across his young shoulder like a shield. He's holding in a story, rain within clouds. He kept that story somewhere tucked in the suitcases and train windows, buses, car rides, planes, over oceans, over continents. Kept it. Four. This is the story that you will lose if you do not ask. River Musi. My beginning lies by the River Musi, bisecting my birthplace between old and new city, tributary and life source to a city of pearls. Musi flows like a thin fissure in a heart now split in two. Polluted river swells and recedes, streaking oily rainbow ripples over glossy water. South of the river, old city, with my father's home and its Shia shrines, heart and eyes, memory of floods and earth that cradles rebellious bones. North of the river, Mallapalli, with my mother's home and its winding streets. Lungs and gut, breath that does not remember when the sky dips low to kiss you. On some other earth, under a different sky, I dream you.
Do you remember me?
Your daughter.
Born at sunset,
beginning of evening. No matter how far, whatever bridge I cross, I kneel by your bank and tenderly cup you in my hands. I love you. At the River Musi, my city becomes whole. moth. It isn't in the wings or the flying where freedom takes place. It is in the quiet cosmos of your unbecoming. In a case of silk, your essence is protected, while imaginal discs shift, molt into mystery, cave in. May a song be an anchor while your body falls into itself. May you find beauty in the reconstruction. Do you remember your simultaneous origin and conclusion? Do you remember how once, in a cocoon, you met yourself?
Moth, too. Right now, I won't talk about the wings or the flying. It's in the beautiful quiet of your undoing that freedom takes place. May you be yourself, fully, completely. Even when you don't know it yet, into mystery, nothing left but becoming. A solo journey between no one else but you and the universe. Is your work. Enter into the heart, melt therein, you and me. Sing inside, in sweet melody. You of creator and created, holding hands with the unseen, a cascade of starlight falling as organs shift. It isn't pretty, but isn't that where true beauty lives? When you love yourself anyway, through implosions unknown. Trust, too. Is the freedom in your ending or beginning? Who are you? Stranger, fluttering, nocturnal. Sometimes I watch you embroider the sky at dawn and dusk. Sometimes, if I follow you, I also follow the stars and moon. You navigate using moonlight and geomagnetic clues. I watch you create a story together. Oh, moth, you work at night, unwitnessed. Your lovers are the night bloom. All night conversations with flowers ensure life. Reminders of interdependence. listen with your wings.
Hyderabad evening. Balmy Dakkan evening makes it easy to weep near parched fountains and crumbling architecture. Where birds dive through cracked arches and solitude helps stitch patches of one's life together. Tears flow with ease as you sit in secluded courtyard and wonder, what was this place before the storm?
This way. Worried and unable to see an end to multiple storms. I wasn't always this sad and afraid. But today serves as a reminder. Years before, I labored, messy and sweaty, fantastically filthy, privately, magnificent. The contractions were punctuation marks, and timing is everything. A kite fell with a flick of a wrist that moves it into a wind current of lift. Do you need an epidural, they asked. No, thank you, I replied, even though I felt like I was being pressed into the earth by the weight of each band of constricting energy, split two, but not breaking. Between you and you. Somewhere on a cliff in the Himalayas, you smelled the fragrance of your own mortality. You found your reflection in the mud. Honored the way you loved, the way your heart broke, how life became living, became generative, regenerative magic. Mimic nature, experienced itself,
When the boulders lodged in your spine finally turned to dust. When you learned how to stand straight. When you laid flowers at the entrance to your womb. When a thread of light lit a river through you. A conduit between Earth's core and infinity. Here, you kissed the middle of your own palm, above the lifeline, below the heart line. Experienced how spirit rests in the colors at the edge of breath. Meridians, small portals to no space or time. You stop longing, wishing, caring, became bone, blood, breath, a heart of four chambers, and release.
First of all, tell everyone who you are, your name.
Well, first, I love you.
I know. And I love you too. You already, you know what I always say, you already know. Mm.
My name is Sham-e-Ali Nayeem.
Even when you say it, it's like, say it again.
Sham-e-Ali Nayeem. And what was the other question?
That's it. We're done. I walked into Liwe, you know, one day with Mayori. When I walk into places and spaces like that, you know, because I'm still, people don't believe that I'm shy. So when I walk into like office spaces with people, you know, and I'm like, it's, I don't know everyone. I'm like, you know, like I'm focused on who I know, Mayori, Denise, and Mayori was like, come here, and you know, office space. I was like, it's a Sham. Sham is, and then next thing you know, here's another day. I'm with you somewhere else, and then here's another time, and then I started hearing your poetic voice. We went to the Asian Arts Initiative. You were doing something. It was like, might have been the first time I ever experienced you sharing your poetry live. And I have silently been watching and observing and befriending and sister shipping, and we've been, you know, all the time growing us and growing our relationship, and even when we don't see each other a lot, but I have loved to see you using your voice out here more and, you know, in different ways. And yeah, that's a blessing for me to be able to see that. You know, to have known you all this time and been building this relationship as women, as humans, yeah, as poets,
yes,
as artists, as mothers.
Yes. Yes, Ursula.
As what people would consider activists, artists for the people, whatever, whatever. Like, we do a host of things that we connect on. So I wanted to talk about that. I wanted to tell you that.
I feel so blessed to get to be called one of your friends, to build with you this way, as sisters, as mothers, you know, to know you for so many years, and very grateful that, you know, we can come here this moment in this pandemic, through the centuries of time that the toll that took,
and I'm
really just
mad,
be here
thankful.
Alive together, to be here yeah. alive together, and
indeed,
get
indeed.
To see you in person this way.
Would have asked everyone, mm-hmm. because the close-up series is called Scars and Emblems, this iteration is called Scars and Emblems, which I didn't make up, but I swear to you, if I was, now I can never have anything called Scars and Emblems, but I would. What resonates with you, if anything, and which of those matters most? That's the language I'm using, matters most, or do they? Scars or emblems, or scars and emblems, or not at all? How do they figure
the
scar, into your life?
I think it's the scar, because in the scar is the miracle of healing. Like, in the scar is a miracle of healing, because the scar is not the open wound. The scar is the miracle,
right,
of the healed wound, and the miraculous partnership between ourself and God and spirit that creates that miracle of healing. So the scar reminds me of the pearl, the same thing where it's like grit and a pearl is formed, and the scar is like the jewels of our healing. And, you know, and almost paying homage to God in that miracle. Because it is miraculous to me. When I have a cut and it heals, and I'm like,
what?
That, my body did that. and you know, yeah, so.
Ooh, and the emblems. Why do people keep on doing that?
Yes,
you know, so
constantly
now.
Healing. Something is always dying within us. Something is always being born or regenerating or healing. And so the emblems is also resonates in that, you know, we hold these miracles with honor.
For close-ups, scars and emblems, please tell me about it. What's in there? What story? Are you telling a story? What's your intention? What's your mission? However you want. What are you saying in your 30-minute, 20-minute, 28-minute artistic journey that we get to like blessedly have with this project?
So I've been reflecting a lot on values and what values drive me and my purpose, and what values, you know, I care about the most in my existence in this world. And so the set kind of highlights those values, which are uplifting life, honoring the lives of others, ending oppression, uplifting love, honoring the miracle of what we were talking about, of healing, of healing from grief, of healing through our challenges, of growing in our spirits, honoring our ancestors, honoring our descendants, our babies. And you know, there's so many different challenges as well. So where is the place that we find liberation in that? Where is the justice? Where is the...
Come on with the word, Sham.
Freedom. You know, even the ways we oppress ourselves in what we internalize. What does it mean to be free in this life?
You're freeing yourself because you're trying new things. You're doing the music. Can we talk about this? Can we talk about you making your own sounds and soundscapes and rhythms and music? I mean, can we talk about this, poet?
Anytime.
Right now, and how you're interweaving it with the words?
So my parents had a friend who had a daughter when I was younger named Giselle. And she taught me piano when I was 7 years old. And she taught me like how to read music. But she would be like, is this boring? Is there a song you like? And then she would transcribe the song and I would learn how to play it.
Wow.
So music has, and like, you know, my parents always had music in the house, and it's always been like a part of my life, but not
Your parents
one.
Play instruments?
They didn't.
Okay.
They didn't, but they played records. and it gave me a love for the record store, and it gave me a love just to be open to every kind of music. And
the record store.
You know it.
The record store.
Yes.
If you don't know, shame on you. I ain't gonna tell you, and neither is Sham. Look it up.
We will not. only the true know.
That's right.
Yeah. But it was poetry too that kind of came into my life around the same time through my dad, who was he loved poetry. He would be quoting poetry all the time, and he taught me that poetry, you know, he almost taught me the ways in which poetry is life, the life that we live. You know, if he did, I didn't get ever to read it. But he certainly shared poems in very beautiful ways at the table, in the car, dropping me to school. There would always be some beautiful, very deep poem for me to think about.
Which one stands out?
Like Muhammad Iqbal, he would quote Ghalib, Urdu poets, he loved them. And, you know, often they write about God and justice and freedom. Yeah. And so I grew up with that. And so I sort of leaned into poetry before leaning into music as an artist, even though I did music. So music was my private space. It would be the space where I would cry at the piano.
But what about poetry? That's not your private
poetry,
space?
I would cry, but also be brave enough to share. But I wasn't brave enough to share the music. For decades of my life, I got a guitar. I taught myself to learn how to play that. I had like a little like Casio, little synth keyboard, and you know, taught myself with that.
The Leo one, figure out how to do all the things.
But I used it as a private space, and it was the pandemic. It was a pandemic that sort of gave me the courage to try to share this other love of mine, and join poetry with it, so because it's poem songs, they're like sonic poems.
So you've done it in this piece.
Yeah.
You know. I love it. I just want to say like congratulations.
Thank you.
Because I'm pushing myself right now all the time. One of my main things right now is come on, Earth, try something new for you. You know, it might not be new in general. Whatever that is, because is anything really new in general? But new for me.
Absolutely. And I feel like as artists, why do people want to box us in a thing? Like now you have to forever be a poet. No, you can be a poet and a fiber artist. You can be a poet and a musician. You can be a poet and a dancer. You can be whatever you want. Maybe there isn't even a name for what you're about to create.
Right.
And like, I don't want anyone containing me in what I'm trying to express and get in deeper to the thing that is the driving force of my life, which are the values again.
Okay, I'm so glad you said it again. Cause like, I feel like, oh, values, like, you know? But when you say it and how you use it, it feels new. I'm like, oh, Sham says it in a way that I like it. You know, all these years they've been rolling a family values.
I know, I was about to say, they take all the best
words
and
ruin it.
They took freedom and ruined that word. How do you ruin the word freedom? They did.
That's a whole nother conversation. And that's a really, ooh, that question. Woof. What's next? You know, you're doing all these new things. So like I asked everyone, meaning, what haven't you done yet?
Oh, there's a lot
that
I haven't.
That you want to do. That you have a dream to do.
Your questions are so beautiful. Because you know what? If there was one thing in the pandemic that like weighed on me in a different way, was just this sense that life is not promised. And we only have a short time to get as much as we can get done in this world to try to make it a better world. And so for me, it gave me more fervor to take all the chances, even if it isn't perfect.
Yeah.
Even if, you know, singing makes me really nervous, but I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna do it, because who knows? Who knows how long I'm gonna be here?
And one of my favorite, I grew up in the Catholic Church, and actually he left the priesthood, this particular priest that ran the youth group. Bully for you, brother! I'm just talking to him up there, wherever he is out there, not being a priest. He used to say, when you sing, you pray twice.
Mm.
All that. I never, ever forgot that. I could see myself sitting in the pew when he said it that day. When he said that, I was like, I swear nobody was paying attention but me. So now, ever since then, I'm like, that's why I want to sing, too.
Yes.
That's what got me to be brave enough to sing, because I was afraid to sing. So sing.
Well, inshallah.
inshallah
with that. But, you know, I want to take more risks in things that I felt very nervous to share in the past. I want to uplift spirit in the work that I do. So I'm working on my second manuscript. I'm working on this second musical album.
Yeah.
And
on the second manuscript? Dang.
Yeah.
Wow.
So,
and
you
and
know,
what else?
And then the second album of poems with now electronic music. So that I've been kind of working on through this pandemic.
I mean, so, like, do you think about what that may bring? Like, when you start doing that, you do an album with electronic music and poems, and have you thought about the possible response or attention or getting invited to do gigs like that? Like, how do you think about
it? I have not thought about gigs.
Okay.
I can barely think about getting to the grocery store, but I mean, yes, someday, yes. But what
fantasy,
I have thought about is like calling in peace, calling in grounding. Mm-hmm. What am I sharing when I share my art that brings in a sense of feeling spacious?
Do you want to call in some peace?
Really? Ursula.
You just said, let's call in some, I know I need it. Can we please call in some peace?
I'm gonna read a really short one.
Please.
It's literally so short.
Bless us.
But it's called The Ocean Fixes Everything.
It's already good.
What happens here is yours. And that's it.
Say it again.
What happens here is yours.
I love you. We will continue. This is just, you know, we're going to keep talking. And thank you so much for saying yes.
Thank you for inviting me.
And to my invitation to be part of Close Up Scars and Emblems, because I know, because we've talked about ours. So I wanted you to be able to share yours and share your story about that. And that was important to me, that all of the, and everyone is connected in all of these conversations. Everyone's saying the same type, like, so I love that, yeah, it's being confirmed that we are
100%.
Stardust.
And you know, as you're saying that, I'm thinking of your dad, I'm thinking of my dad, and them looking over us.
Our sons.
Our sons. This is so much bigger than just poetry and performance to me. Our friendship.
I love you.
I love you too.
Thank you. We will continue.
Inshallah.